the very process of filmmaking, distribution, and consumption. Now, what is this party trying to say? Filmmaking or film policy in Nigeria across other countries in the sub-Saharan Africa. He has identified three countries basing his work on: Nigeria, Ghana, and South Africa. Now, if we take the primary definition of policy, we are told that a policy is a deliberate system of principles to guide decisions and achieve rational outcomes. We are also told that policy is a statement of intent which will be implemented as a procedure, or as a protocol. And this is either for government or private or public organizations. Film policy. From my take in this paper, Dr. Patrick is simply telling us that in as much as the film industry in Nigeria, as it were, and other African and sub-Saharan and Anglophone African countries are concerned, that the existing policies that guide the operation of the industry seems to him not to be enough, not to be doing too good as to giving the film industry in this selected Anglophone sub-Saharan African states the impetus not just for profit, having considered that film in itself, as we practice it, as Oga said yesterday, mercantilism and the cultural aspect of that is the culture and the mercantile aspect of it. So, if film is a phenomenon that is founded on those two pedestals, culture and money making or mercantilism, it therefore behoves the a set of rules and regulations guiding the operation of the industry. And Dr. Patrick Okun is telling us that from his analysis of the three sub-Saharan African countries, that it doesn't seem to him that these policies, although they look good on paper in theory, that practically in its implementation, he is not satisfied with the way the policy is affecting the industry, both in its popularity, in the financial aspect of the industry itself, the contextual and theoretical conceptions also. Dr. Patrick, in his paper, has identified what he calls, what he seems to think would be what he proposes as the ideal film policy that he thinks, he believes, will work effectively for the industry. So if you look at page 7, he says that for him, what he considers the ethical political approach to film policy. And he's simply saying here that today the film policies in these three sub-Saharan and Anglophone African countries, as it were propounded or made by the government, without the practitioners of industry themselves having any input into those policies. Now, if you consider our studies in community journalism, we're told that the people are saying, don't sit there and make policies for us and decide for us how you want, what you think is good enough for us. In your process of thinking for us, thinking, we know you have good intentions for us, we know you think well about us, but let it not be that the plants, the good plants you have for us, that you're the sole arbiter of knowing where the shoe pains us and what medicine you should give to us. So Dr. Patrick O'Connor is saying, if this is how the frame policies in these three sub-Saharan and African countries were made, then he believes that all of that was
based on the political conversation of the state. And so we think that there should be a political context where we want the practitioners, the independent filmmakers, the local filmmakers, to be part of that policy, to have the state, to have the constitution in that policy that will guide the industry. Now, let's take the example of the convention. Today we know that the film industry in Nigeria is guided or is governed by an existing market economy that does not allow
for
by the government and to display the cultural content of the film.
Because, as Ogun has pointed out here, because the film policy has existed
in paper, has not been implemented even in the core content as it were, which allows for the government to put some money into the filmmaker's pocket or put some, give some form of loan or some form of financial support to filmmaking. Therefore, government would have been able to say, okay, be able to say, look at the film content.
The state of your film and the finished product to see if your product has
will offer well for our cultural representation or will fit well for our countries and all of that. But because government is not putting money into this film,
the independent marketers who plow in their money and their resources into this film making want to sell their film to make their money, and so they will go the whole hog with whatever content or thematic plans that they believe will sell. And Dr. Ogun is saying that because the film is a cultural platform as well as money making platform, that one is big. Why the film puts money into our company is also speak to our culture and system. And so, that the government should bring in the policy makers, should bring in those who make the films. So come and sit in a round table like this and say, okay, in terms of distribution, this is how we want it to go. In terms of policy on piracy, this is how we want it to go. In terms of this, the content and training and the manpower development and all of that, this is how we want it to go. And so at the end of the day, all of them would have been able to contribute
a sense
of how they feel about the industry into that policy. Which means that if they are part of the policy making, they will also must be, as it must be, part of the policy implementation. But now, okay, let's look at this. If you make, you give me these rules to go and play with, because I wasn't able to make these rules, I might still reluctant. I may not even be spiritually
or conscientiously
bound to follow the contents of your policy. But if I were in the process, in the making, in that policy making process, and everything there we agreed that nobody should produce two films in a month. It is a policy that nobody should produce so that so content of films. We will be the watchdog for ourselves. It will be easier to implement those policies. Now, why do we need policies? Why do we need policies in filmmaking? When we have policies in filmmaking, we'll talk about our policy as it affects the economic policies of the country. The economic policies of the country affects the policies, even our policies that exist for both private and social businesses. And as Ogun has pointed out here, a policy, an economic policy or financial policy that does not allow the filmmaker to plow in as little as he can get to be able to get out as much as he can is not a good policy for him. A policy where he makes a film today and before he will be able to sell 100 copies of his film, the pirates and the producers and independent other marketers would have sold millions of those copies. So I'm going to say, now this is not good for us. This is not good for the industry. If the industry must move forward, that those who produce this film must be part of that filmmaking process. Now, as part of from verse 7 to 18, he has done an extensive work analyzing the three countries, Nigeria, Africa, South Africa, and Ghana frame policies. So we'll leave at that and go straight to see how he concluded this paper and see how we can speak to his conclusions also. Part of his conclusion I read. The paper has argued for the broadening of the sociopolitical dynamics for co-regulation along the logic of the ethical / political framework. According to Dr. Koo, he thinks that the rationale is to ensure that the inclusion of the empathically and moral considerations of the citizenship, and in this case, those who make the films, in the official film policy agendas and evaluation of the government will augur well for the film industry. From there, he went on to make some conclusive statements that the paper also concludes that it is also necessary that for all stakeholders to work together to continue to create meaningful interface between commercialism and cultural considerations in the national film policy debates, as well as to ensure ongoing respect for regional trade and cultural policy agreements in the policy decision. He therefore makes some recommendations. What he thinks, if done, will help the film industry industry, sub-Saharan and full African countries grow better. In one of the recommendations, he says that he thinks that the adoption of what he has propounded as the ethical political policy framework and includes open administrative approach by industry regulators to broaden participation. He also recommends the need for the formation of separate representatives or representation by short filmmakers outside those provided by the independent television industry and the elite marketers to enable them partner more meaningfully with diverse industry organizations. Now, having looked at what his recommendations, we also make bold to add some recommendations to what he has done. Because as part of the practitioners of industry and scholars of industry, we think we added our voice to what Kun has said, that it would go a long way to help this industry grow. And to add our recommendations, we are guided, as lifted here, from a recommendation by the British Council of Ministers on Policies and Diversity of African of Filmmaking Globally. And in their recommendation, first they said that a review of the national film policies, they recommend a review of national film policies, taking into account markets and technological changes needed to improve policy decisions. They think that this in turn will determine where